Hot mic. All right. Well, welcome everybody. We are back. We've got UNI Purple versus Graceland University. It was week seven, because last week the last team forfeited, so UNI Purple is 3-3. I'm Joe, by the way. I'm here tonight with Zach.
I'm Zach. I'm joining Joe here today.
How you doing?
Pretty good so far. Ready to get into this game today. See what these guys got going.
I'm currently trying to look at Graceland University on op.gg, but one of their guys is a hard to spell name, so it's taking me a second.
Yeah, I don't see a link for their OP either in any of the channels.
I'll send you one to our group chat here in a second. Remy, do you have a stream for us? Okay.
Hopefully they're not like last week's team. We get a good game today.
Yeah, not really sure what happened with last week's team, but it was over before it started, kind of deal.
Yeah, it can be tough just to get a team together sometimes, just to coordinate all these times. So, one aspect the UNI team's got going good for them, they're consistently together.
So I wasn't able to find out what their bot laner would be. I hear that you're a Renekton main.
I have gotten a few games of Renekton in my day, personally.
The Croc?
Some people might call me a one trick. I prefer just to say I got a favorite champion. What lane do you call home?
I've called many lanes home, but the one that I called home for a long time was ADC. I have a lot of points on Jhin.
It's a tough journey. Very dangerous and very scary.
Dude, I have left ADC the last like year and a half. Top lane is where it's at.
It seems like ADC, it can be strong, but it from what I've seen in my years of playing, ADC strength really comes from how strong the assassins are in the game. Because they can just get oppressed by so many other champions. If they don't get the chance to be strong, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, especially during metas where assassins are so prevalent, it turns into, okay, I gotta beat him. Support, are you gonna like help me? Or
goes into, can you dodge Rengar fast enough?
Yeah. Most of the time you can't. Which is why I'm like, hey, support, please help me.
Yeah, most of the time as the ADC, unfortunately, you die before you can react, so it's not a very fun journey. At least with after they added the mythic items, having that Gale Force for a lot of those matchups really helped.
I love Gale Force. I love the dash. Oh, we have a stream?
If only Stridebreaker still had that dash too.
Yeah, I was going to say, I miss Stridebreaker's dash. It was a little stupid on, like, Darius and Garen.
Yeah, it was broken on Darius.
It was really broken on Darius, but it was pretty fun.
But I like all the broken items. You know, when Shojin was in the game, Crocodile was just a blast.
Oh yeah, the original Shojin, that was fun.
Probably hurt my game more than it helped it, honestly, because I got too gung-ho about fights all the time.
Renekton's in a weird spot, and has been.
I played him today, and it felt pretty good.
Uh-huh.
I'm not too familiar on the new builds. I tried the Blade of the Ruined King Rush, and it seemed really strong.
Yeah, it is.
I was versus Nasus, so that matchup is usually pretty easy.
Easy early.
Yeah, as long as you can keep the Nasus suppressed, he's kind of just doomed. And luckily, I was doing pretty well, and then my mid lane Lissandra was also doing pretty well.
Lissandra's also in an odd spot. There's just characters that do what those characters do, but, like, faster? I don't know. I mean, with Renekton, it feels like you either build tank and do no damage, or you build damage and you are so squishy. And I haven't played a ton of Renekton, but...
Yeah, he definitely goes through phases. I've played him in all different playstyles. My favorite was definitely more the tank playstyle. I used to rush Black Cleaver, and you would get...
Yeah, I like the tank style. I don't like the Eclipse rush, or not even rush, but build with him.
Yeah, you'd even get to Locket with that build back in the day, because with all the health scaling Locket has.
I forgot about Locket. That's a fun
item. You would just...
Okay.
Give me 1 second to grab my water here.
No worries. Graceland is up to ban first. I think that means they first pick, right? Ban Gensel's Rakan. That's a good move. Gensel's pretty nasty on the Rakan.
Rakan can destroy a lot of bot lanes. That's probably a good ban from them. Open up a lot of their choices.
Now, I did play a game with Aiden last night, and he did go Dr. Mundo jungle. It was interesting. I'm interested to see if he tries it today.
He got some solid buffs for the jungle, so it could be very well good.
I think it will kind of depend on how fed and what the enemy jungle picks. Because if the enemy jungle runs away with it, Mundo has a hard time because he's got a scale up. I don't know, though. His ganks are really weird. If he hits the cleaver, it does so much damage.
People underestimate the Mundo ganks, but if you're up in lane, once you get hit by one cleaver, you're just doomed. You just stack the cleavers the rest of the way back to tower. So you have to be really careful with an opposing Mundo jungler that you're very aware of the jungler's positioning.
So we see Maokai ban, interesting. We know Aiden likes to pick Maokai in the jungle, and Unite Purple bans Fiora and Zac. I think Fiora's a good ban. They've had a hard time dealing with Fiora in the past.
From what I've seen on their play, Fiora can definitely be a good ban because it can control the top lane, and you want to have like an open top lane matchup. You don't want to have one opposing laner to have full control. Really limits team comps.
You're right, and I also want to point out they banned Brayden's Ornn. He has not been able to play Ornn at all during this season. Ornn has been banned every single game.
Ornn's just one of the worst laners to play against, coming from a top laner. He just rushes tank. Then you have no fun as the other top laner.
Alright, so they're going to take Xayah away from bot. I think that's good. Tyler usually pops off on Xayah. It's good for Grayson. I don't know about you and I. We'll see. We'll see if he goes like Zeri. He likes Zeri. I've seen him go Kai'Sa. Or if he'll pop out something new. I think he would kick ass on Ashe. Sorky.
That Mundo comes up, that Sorok, it could make him nearly unkillable.
Yeah, I was about to say, we're going to see from top and jungle, or even if Bailey Joe goes Swain mid, that'd be kind of nasty. Okay, so Tyler is going to go Zeri this game. Ew, Yumi. Bot lane is going to be pretty chill until jungler shows up.
Yeah, there shouldn't be much action with two Enchantress supports bottom, so it should be a pretty farm fest down there.
Ooh, Sejuani. Wonder if that's top or jungle.
My gut always says jungle, but it can be a very safe top laner to
Dude,
play.
It's so fun top.
You just chill and
as the opponent laner, it's very boring. She just saves her jump, and then anytime you try to engage, she jumps away.
Ooh.
This Soraka with Mundo could be very strong. They need to Graceland needs to make sure they pick up any executioner's item really early.
Yeah. It could be Mundo top, but I have a feeling it's going to be Aiden going Mundo jungle. I don't think it's a bad pick versus Sejuani, because you have a free CC block.
Would be another boring lane, though, which would make mid lane very, very exciting. A lot of jungler action on mid lane if that is a Sejuani top and a Mundo top.
We'll see. Usually when Bailey Jo gets the Seraphine, UNI Purple wins just because she's able to play so safe in lane and just like wait for the big team fights to happen and consistently land ult, so they just ban away Seraphine. And the Veigar. Rude.
Probably banning two mid laners there would be safe, though, because they don't know where that Mundo is going right now. So probably decent options for bans for Graceland there. With the flex picks UNI has going on right now.
I think Graceland's mid laner, I'm not going to say they're going to go Renekton, but there is a possibility.
Renekton can be very strong mid lane, but the dash becomes a lot weaker. Because it's the whole lane, so you can't really abuse it as much top lane.
Pantheon, I don't know if that's going to be mid or top. That's a good flex pick. Ooh, Aurelion Soul.
Based off the team comp so far, it's going to be a really important factor whichever team's more coordinated, because these team fights are going to be quite long. There's not going to be much quick popping action going on, so it's really
going
to make sure you're coordinated and together and know everybody's going in and out at the same time.
They're going to have to keep a good eye on Aurelion Soul. His roams can be pretty annoying once he starts getting rolling.
As long as they have good communication, that can usually be avoided though in team comp, so hopefully they can just keep a good voice comp going out there.
I'm pretty sure the Gwen thinks it's Mundo top, because I think Pantheon smacks Gwen, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know who is top in mid or top in jungle, but I'm gonna look.
Familiar with that Gwen Pantheon matchup, but I don't.
Gwen loses to Pantheon.
I feel like Gwen should be able to at least survive with their damage reduction area.
It's true, but if Pantheon ever gets his empowered W off, she's pretty sad.
Yeah, the Pantheon is the blocks is W or E.
The block is his E. The stun is his W.
Yeah, the E will be very, very strong in this lane just because Gwen needs to walk up to his face to try to hit him.
Yeah, it's pretty obvious. So he could just E it. But he could be jungle because we don't know who picked what. I'm not sure. We'll find out. I kind of want it to be Mundo jungle.
That would be interesting.
Especially because Gwen kind of poops on Mundo and top.
Mundo matchups top are you always pretty safe, though. You can always go back to Q farming if you need to.
That's true. be right back.
Isn't the most exciting part for commentators, but from a player perspective, this is the most important part of the game right now when you're talking of your strategies for the game here. Now that you have your team comps locked in, you kind of know what strategy and what your goals are. They're now trying to form what lanes they want to prioritize, what lanes are going to be their weak lanes, and where their jungler is going to emphasize his pressure at. Once we find out which lane is which, we should know. So it is that Gwen v Pantheon on top. And like we were talking about, if the Pantheon uses his E correctly, it can be very difficult for the Gwen to try to make any plays.
We're also going to have to watch out for Sejuani. I think she's going to be able to do more sooner than Dr. Mundo. So if she knows that, that could be bad for you and I, Purple.
Mundo's first clear isn't as bad as most people usually think it is because of the percent health damage on his Q. So Mundo can actually probably get top as quickly as Sejuani this game if he wants to.
Have you ever played Darius jungle?
I've given it a little few attempts, nothing serious, but I've tried it.
What are your thoughts?
It's not as good as Darius top lane.
That's true.
Yeah, it's a solid champion, and it provides a lot of fight power. But from the jungler perspective, it just doesn't really provide enough like engage potential. With Darius, you're really limited to those fights. If you don't have flash up, you have to be very careful with your positioning. If you have flash up on Darius, you can flash E somebody. It's pretty game-changing. But otherwise, as a jungler, you're kind of not really doing your job.
So I don't think we've seen Bill pick, Bailey Joe pick Cassiopeia in one of these games. I don't know, a league.
I'm a giant fan of the champion, personally. I haven't seen her on it much myself either, but the champion itself I find really good for a competitive play.
Yeah, I know she can play it, I just haven't seen it, so I'm pretty excited.
It's one of the few mid laners that can split push extremely well. Her Miasma gives her the opportunity to play a lot more aggressive than other champions would.
Yeah, it'll help later against Gwen and Sejuani. Sejuani can't use her Q when she's on it.
No, it'll really help against Aurelion Sol. If she's ever in a side lane and Aurelion tries to come to match, you can just throw it out and he gets canceled.
If you were Sejuani and Dr. Mundo, where would you gank first? And you know, what would you be thinking about?
So, as a top lane player, I do normally prioritize top lane ganks, just because I find that lane to be the most volatile lane.
Yeah, I think that would be a great idea this game with the Pantheon.
In this game, if I was either, I would be more focused on farming early and just being reactable. I don't think there's going to be any major plays happening pre-level 4 or 5 from the junglers. I think it's more just going to be try to get a solid quick start so you can more focus on the mid-game fights.
I gotta agree with you. I would just be farming in my jungle, praying my laners do their best to not die, and put out wards when they can, so we can keep track of Sejuani. Because if you know where Sejuani is, theoretically you can't die to her. You just back off when you know if she's coming.
Yeah, none of these lanes in these matchups look incredibly volatile, so it should be able to just maintain a nice even lane state matchups. Curious to see if UNI tries to invade.
We usually see one at each entrance to the jungle, so like two top and three bot. And usually it has gotten UNI jungler Aiden punished. He'll sometimes go for a deep ward, and he has been caught a couple of times. But usually when that happens in a series, it doesn't happen again.
The reason I brought it up is because I believe the Mundo invade is very, very strong. Because if you land one Q, you're pretty much forcing a flash, which is very, very strong.
Yeah. So I'm betting on Dr. Mundo going into a pixel brush and waiting a sec and then walking forward and warding, or something like that.
Yeah, the safest bet's down for him to start topside.
If I were Pantheon, I'd be waiting in a bush. Try to get any early damage on the Gwen that I can. Don't let her touch the farm as much as I can.
Mundo won't be able to do too much, unfortunately, but he also won't be able to lose it all, so that lane should be very easy. As long as the Pantheon can use the E correctly, because the Gwen can't really have any options for fights.
Yeah, as long as he goes in frequently, because that's important. Because he could just beat her, as long as the second part, when she goes to like fight him back, he needs to E at the right time. Because if he doesn't, he just loses it.
Yeah, the retaliation's very important.
Rami, we're gonna need a new stream. Yeah, I don't know what the heck is up with the newest league patch, but when you stream on Discord, it will automatically like stop the stream whenever you like switch from client to in-game. It's very odd.
So it does look like we're going to see a 5-point here from UNI, just taking the safe route.
Interesting that Gwen is doing. She's getting pretty deep. Not super deep. She's toeing the line.
With the... when you're posting up with the 5-point, most of the time it's honestly better to be a bit further out, because it gives you vision further out so you can see them earlier. If you try to hide too close to corners sometimes, you don't actually get vision enough to respond to it enough.
Yeah, I've had that happen. I've seen that happen many a times.
So, one thing I might say, I haven't been watching too closely, but if the Zaya on the blue team, they would want to be higher up towards the bush in the river so they could see that. The team could walk around that corner, and depending on their skills, they would have to flash to dodge.
100% agree. I've seen it happen so many times in that tri-bush and bot lane.
I've been punished by it too many times.
It happens a lot in the entrance to the jungle that they're right next to as well, up and to the right a little bit, near that pixel brush. If you're too far back in the bush, the whole team can like pop around that corner really quick. Some early skills are being thrown, some trades happening. It's hard to say that you're coming out on top of a trade with the Yumi. But we'll see from bot lane.
We're seeing a lot of action bot lane, but most of this action is just supports trying to get their gold.
I think what they're trying to do is just burn them down as much as they can right now, because when there's a Yumi, with the new Yumi, it's like a time-based thing. Not totally time, but just like the longer you wait, the more you're giving them room to come back. So
yeah,
they're just trying
for
to.
For you and I, the Yumi doesn't have a lot of great targets to hop on during big team fights. There's no
yeah.
way you can just turn into a light steel tank.
So Brayden's got to be careful top. Sejuani is going for this early gank. At level 3, we'll see if Dr. Mundo immediately invades. He knows. He's immediately... No, he's not. He's going back to his thing. But...
Flash from Sejuani and then a flash from Pantheon and he's out.
Not bad.
That will be a little dangerous, though, for our Pantheon. The flash on the laner is definitely more valuable than the flash on the jungler. He has to play a lot safer for this next 5 minutes.
Yeah, especially because Sejuani is taking that scuttle, and if he pushes out, she can come right back.
Luckily, it's like the wave's pushing to him, so he should be nice and safe. He's getting a little low.
Yeah, he did try to eat that Q. That's a Gwen Q. That was good. The Yumi is like out of mana trying to keep Xayah alive. So UNI Purple is doing a pretty good job bot lane.
Bottom.
Yeah.
Looks like Mundo might be booming up there.
Meanwhile, top is being dove. Gets the kill on the Sejuani because he W'd the Sedge and ignited her. So well played by Brayden. Not going down without a fight. Get a little bit of gold. It could have been a lot worse with no kill.
Yeah, if I was the Pantheon right now, I'd be trying to come back to lane as fast as possible.
Yeah,
push that lane back out and try to roam and equalize that kill, because the Pantheon will have about a minute of free downtime when this Gwen has to back.
I don't think Gwen even has to. She's full health, has most of her mana. She might just stay up there and be annoying. That's what I would do.
It's the gold she has to spend at this point. She has like probably 1,000 gold on her.
Oh, she does choose to do it. Is she going to teleport back or walk back? She teleports. We see UNI Purple bot lane trying to do a little bit of a cheese, but they don't realize that the enemy bot lane is in their nexus. Or maybe they know, but don't care. I think they realize. Pantheon and Gwen having a little lover spat. He
really
W's in on her. Oh, Gensel does get executed trying to push up that wave. You hate to see it. Pantheon, after the spat, does opt to back. I think that's good. I think he's got the feeling that Sedge is topside because she is.
Yeah, he just doesn't want this lane to get too crazy. So as long as he gets his farm and gets out, he's being successful right now.
Mm-hmm. Ronnie's stealing UNI Purple's Raptors instead
Pantheon
of...
Pantheon is coming back to a bit of a scary position top, though. This Gwen has this wave frozen out with Sejuani topside. Pantheon must
yeah.
be very careful.
I think Sejuani's going to go for it as soon as she sees that UNI Purple is taking Drake.
He's got that pink and tri-brush. Hopefully you can see this quickly.
He sees her.
Nice
work. That was great.
And that's where that pink comes in real handy. 75 gold for his life. Very worth it.
One big bot wave here.
If I were Mundo here, I might try to pressure this opposing bot lane off the wave.
I would too.
Bony top, and we see this wave being about frozen out. You could really start to deny these guys.
It looks like he's going to go deny Sejuani instead in her jungle. Maybe not. I would commit. Go to her red. She is backing. We'll see if she runs into him, because that's where she's going. He can get the red and get out, but if he gets greedy and gets Raptors or Krugs, he's going to get caught. I think he should get red and go straight bot, because they're fighting and they're low. This is a good fight bot. Maybe not. Sedge is gone straight there. It's really odd. Not a whole lot happening.
You know we'll be getting your Raptors.
He is.
You
must know that. Oh, bot lane doesn't realize that Sejuani is there. They have no vision, and they're pushed out pretty far. Sejuani going in for the gank, and Zaya getting a couple feathers out. Is she going to get the root? She does. Zeri is caught, but she cleanses out, flashes out too. There goes the Soraka exhaust. Sejuani is still running Zeri down. Zeri's going to die. Unfortunate for UNI Purple, but Soraka does get it out.
And unfortunately, that's one of the situations where this early game where we don't want to overstep. It's very early on, that wave was crashing. There's not really too much going to do to a Yumi under turret. Might have been better there just to back off as soon as you saw the wave was crashing.
They are still pretty ahead in CS.
Ooh, it might be very greedy from the Zaya, though.
Yeah, it is. I think it is. I don't know, because she could push this and back immediately, and it's totally fine. Maybe.
If the Zeri stepped up, he could stop the back.
Is he gonna stop it? Nah, not in time. Both junglers are topside again. Graceland is pinging the Rift Herald. They think they want to do it. We'll see if there's an interesting fight coming here. Here comes Mundo walking straight at Sedge. He gets spotted by the Scryer's Bloom. Bot's just taking care of vision. Not a lot happening. We're gonna reach the 10-minute mark. Not a lot of kills. I mean, I don't know if it's gonna stay like this all game.
I have faith that once these guys can start grouping up together, there's gonna be a lot more action. But like we predicted, none of these lanes have a lot of prio by themselves. They can't really start too many fights without assistance. So
maybe once they get their items, their mythics, there'll be some action. But I guess we're not getting too much until then, because people are shooting their abilities, they're poking, but I mean, Sejuani's on Rift Herald. It doesn't look like Dr. Mundo notices. Or maybe he does. Because Cassiopeia's not going up. And Cassiopeia might be getting caught by Sedge here soon. I don't know. Bot lane, Yumi ults, they do lose the Zeri, and they do lose the Soraka too. That's unfortunate. Sorry, I was looking at the map. I didn't realize that they were fighting.
It looked like she got a little too aggressive with positioning there, and the Zaya got that booted off with her ult. It's a big cooldown. You don't expect the Zaya to necessarily use offensively a lot of times and catch you off guard.
Speaking of being caught off guard, Pantheon was doing a little bit of investigation in that top river and does receive an Aurelion Soul ult to the face. Where was he going?
I'm not sure. It looked like he had some free time. That wave was coming and pushing him. It's like he maybe just overstepped it too much. Didn't think that the Juani was topside.
Well, he's going to have a problem here soon, because I think his presence would be appreciated at the Drake, but I don't know. Because UNI Purple does not
I have the positioning to go for it. In fact, they are going to be engaged on by Sejuani here. They're doing her best to kite away, but it's inevitable that Sejuani queues straight onto her. Mundo coming in for the clutch gank. He does flash in, misses a cleaver. Ooh, the Zaya does some damage. The Cassiopeia ult gank. Okay, Cass gets a kill. That's a good kill. And Aurelion Soul matches by TPing. Interesting. Where he was. I was in mid. My bad. So it's a pretty good pick for UNI Purple. It sucks that, I was really worried that they were going to die. Especially the Zeri, especially with the positioning at the start.
The Zeri played it very well, using that escape over the wall to build this.
Aurelion Soul doing a big combo over the wall and the Drake pit is not able to kill any of UNI Purple, but they are pretty low, and Sejuani is on the way, and they're going to get the Drake out from him. That's insane. That's I'm sorry. Yeah, he W'd over the wall and ulted during his, and E'd during his W, and just like was using his breath too, and just breathing on everyone.
Yeah, they were all already fairly low, so it's really scary. Aurelion Soul's pretty strong right now. If I was the Sejuani, I would have stayed with that and maybe tried to at least get a good charge on mid. Getting that tier 2 mid can be very destructive for the enemy team.
Yeah, especially if they want to keep snowballing this. But UNI is, excuse me, down, what, 5,000 gold here? They do have their work cut out for them. 4,000 gold now.
Yeah, I think the bigger issue for them isn't going to be the gold. It's going to be the levels they've lost from those unlucky trades where the wave crashed in and died. Because right now, both top and bot lane are down XP.
You're right.
It's going to make it very difficult for them to live life just in one.
We're going to have to see what the mid laners do, especially Bailey Joe. They're going to have to do a little bit of carrying because they're the only ones not like extremely behind, although they're starting to fall behind. Oh, Sejuani going for a gank from the cove, the alcove, and catches Bailey Joe off guard. That was well played by Graceland. They walked in from the... I've done it before. If you path like all the way along the bot walls, you oftentimes don't get spotted, and you can walk through the brush and go into the alcove. Really sneaky.
Yeah, it's a very dangerous play to catch you off guard.
Gwen going for some turret damage and taking some herself. Not able to do too much to the Pantheon. But she does have her item, so he can't fight her. Ooh, Aurelion Soul roaming and a gank top. Are they gonna dive him? Or are they just gonna take the turret? He's just
looks
gonna
like
give.
They're just gonna force this turret down.
I'm not worried. We've seen UNI Purple come back from much worse, with way worse drafts. And I have faith in the Mundo jungle late game. It's going
to
be...
To group up a bit, and they should be in a very good situation.
It's going to be really important for Mundo to peel later, because he's got so much health, he can just kind of, I don't know, block or run people down and buy space. But outside of that, I mean, if any of UNI Purple gets caught, is what I'm saying, they're toast.
I feel like UNI has the stronger team fight with Pantheon being able to hop on specific targets a bit more easily than Gwen and at least not be removed right away.
They do if they're ahead, but because the Pantheon is behind, he doesn't like get a guaranteed kill on anybody, and everybody on UNI Purple is behind. And Gwen is actually going to 1v2 UNI Purple bot lane. Is she going to be able to kill both? She does kill the Soraka. Zeri is kiting for her life, but there's nothing that she can do. Gwen is so ahead. Gwen doesn't want to keep going. Interesting. She got Zeri's shield bow and just backed off.
Yeah, UNI Purple's team comp is good if they're all rolling, but if they're not, then, like, if Pantheon stuns someone, if they all focus that one person, they're dead, that person will die, but the rest of the team, rest of Graceland is so strong that it doesn't matter, and the rest of the team fight is kaput.
Yeah, my thought was the Pantheon's almost a great distraction at this point, because once he hops on the Zaya, they will need to... quite a bit of attention paid towards him, and I can give the Zeri a good opportunity to get a really good positioning in the team fight going and start really getting some damage off.
He's got to go through a lot of people to get to that Zaya, though. If we actually see like a back-to-back 5-5 fight, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't think Pantheon benefits from those fights, so I don't even know if they'll happen. He likes the scrappy fights.
I think he's more of a sacrificial lamb for these fights, so the Zeri and Cascadia.
They thought that they could catch the Gwen, but they were not able to catch the Gwen in time. They did catch her, but they just need a little bit more time before Graceland University showed up.
That those levels and all those extra tank stats, those few levels provide that allowed that Gwen to survive.
Mm-hmm. You and I down, what, 8,000 gold now?
Sorry. Yeah, down a lot of gold. Get a lot of gold on one person right now, so that person can attempt to fight back and play around them. I think if they can try to get Bailey fed, that's their best option.
I agree. I think it's a little bit past time for Zeri to be strong. She's just going to have to wait.
Yeah, hopefully you can get Cassiopeia to the point where she can self-sustain in the side lane. Instead of drawing a lot of pressure.
Baron is up now. We will see what goes on. Sejuani was bot side and back, and so is Gwen. I think they're gonna head top side here. We'll see. Graceland does not have much vision top side, so maybe they won't go for Baron. And also, Sejuani is bot side, so. We'll see.
This could work out very well for them. If Bailey can draw a lot of the people bottom, they might be able to sneak a Baron here. If she can force a lot of people to match her bottom, they have an advantageous team fight around Baron that could be beneficial. Looks like she's just trying to group up with the team, though, stay safe for now.
Yeah, I think it's too late. I don't know if UNI Purple can do this big team fight at this point because they're behind.
It's really tough to stay in that side lane and draw pressure when you're just a little bit more down than the enemy laners.
It looks like Graceland is gonna jump on the opportunity to take Rift, or not Rift, my bad, Baron.
Good to see a really big steal here.
He's a god! He always gets the steal! Like 99% of the time, Aiden gets those steals. Raiden is going and holding off the rest of the team while UNI Purple is catching the Gwen. I'd say that's worth. They lost the Pantheon.
Very worth that.
They got the Baron. They need to not die here. The Yumi is ulting in. Oh, that. The Aurelion ult melted the Dr. Mundo. Cassiopeia crumbles. Zaya, she's so strong. She's running them down. But they do kill her, and they're gonna get this Yumi. There's an ace for you and I. Tyler always pops off, too. It's the classic you and I pop off. That is literally classic you and I purple.
Yeah, this Zeri is now the tool they need to get back into this game.
UNI Purple just needs to not do anything too crazy. I mean, they need to get some kills and like keep getting a lead back, but because they're still behind, they can't forget that.
I think they're honestly in a really good spot right now. They just got to... They made the game so it's no longer in an immediate lose position. So they now have plenty of time just to equalize the game and steady themselves and get ready
right.
for the next play. Instead
but,
of being on the back foot the whole game. Oh, this could be bad.
He already doesn't have Baron, right? Yeah, so it's okay.
These offset death timers could be really bad for UNI, though.
Yeah, it's going to be kind of awkward, especially with Drake coming up right now. Oh man, the Sejuani ults, the Cassiopeia, it's over. And the Aurelion! Interesting. So Sejuani ulted Cass ulted the whole Graceland team, and then Aurelion ult hit. That was weird. That's interesting. Graceland's down two ults. I think that's good for UNI Purple, but it's really bad that the Cassiopeia is down, because that was a lot of their damage.
Yeah, so, he staggered this time. It's really dangerous. You can't contest the dragon with four people. And the
yeah.
enemy knows that, so they're just going to send all five there.
Zaya is going a little bit off the reservation here, but doesn't look like anything is going to come of it.
If Graceland gets this third Ocean Drake, it could also be very difficult late game for UNI to actually kill anybody. Once it's Sejuani,
oh yeah,
the Ocean Drake, it's going to be very, very tanky, boy.
And the Yumi, that'd be really annoying. Constantly getting mana back. Oh! Pantheon goes to check the bush and finds the Sejuani right to the face, gets queued. There's
flash is last second too.
That Gwen damage. She's quite a bit. Top lane's being sieged pretty hard by four people on Graceland right now. But they're gonna back off. Take some jungle camps. They're just pushing it in, waiting for UNI Purple to miss up. They're walking over wards, so they're gonna find it.
Yeah, I think Graceland's just kinda waiting for the next objectives to come up. Graceland is overstepping a couple times, though. A few of their guys are getting a little too gung-ho about going in, and they're getting a little too deep in the jungle. If UNI can find one of those situations to take advantage of, it could be very big for them.
Yeah, UNI needs to follow Pantheon around. And, like, when he W's someone, they just jump him. Because outside of Cassiopeia ult, that's the only hard CC they have. I mean, I guess Rocket E.
Rooted.
They're setting a trap, but I think there might... I don't know. Cass is bot. She's backing. Gwen does have TP up, and so does Aurelion Soul, so it doesn't matter where they go. Little TP to the fight. UNI Purple's in a precarious position. We're gonna see if Aiden tries to steal this Baron again. I don't know if he's gonna get away with it again, but he is a fiend for stealing. Like I said, he played Mundo with me last night. He stole a dragon in that game. So I don't know. I don't know what it is about that guy, but he is born to steal jungle objectives.
The situation is very scary though, like you were mentioning. One's pushing top and has TP for this.
Ooh, they're gonna collapse on them in the jungle. Are they? Sedge doesn't want it. I think Sedge should have gone in there with Aurelion because Xayah was on the other side. They could have totally caught Mundo.
If I was Graceland right now, I would just be starting the Baron with 20 TP.
True.
Oh yeah, Graceland should just take Baron right now.
It looks like they are. In exchange, they're gonna, UNI Purple's gonna go for Gwen here. Drake is coming up in 30 seconds, so maybe they'll get the pressure for that, but it doesn't look like it because the Gwen damage is so high on that Mundo. He's gonna have to back off and just go look for the Drake pressure
himself. It's a very tough situation for UNI with the powerful Gwen pushing in. You can't really force her to back away, so you can't really get that 5v5 at Baron.
Mm-hmm. So it looks like they're gonna dive on this area right here, and she's. Might get caught. Nah, she's over the wall. She's out.
Black
they are damage. Threatening. They're threatening to take the base if UNI Purple goes for the Drake. And UNI Purple's tank is taking the Drake. They can't do anything. They're going to try to fight here, but I don't think it's going to work. It's going to be really relying on Zeri to hit all of her Qs. She's trying, but the minions are in the way. She can't fight that. She's going to die. Sejuani knows, chases in. Cassiopeia counter ults, and so does Xayah. There's a lot going on here. Zeri ults too. Everybody's caught up to each other. Now it's 5v5 and everyone walks away. Interesting.
So Graceland did get an inhib there, and I will give them a lot of dragon pressure.
That's true.
Looks like they're just going to back away and take the dragon now, get their fourth dragon.
Aiden is looking for the steal, but he runs into Gwen. There's nothing he can do. He gets destroyed by her. Look at that. Just gone.
Melted. It's a lot of damage he's Gwen going to put out there.
Mm-hmm. You and I are down 10,000 gold. Their back's against the wall. We've seen them come back.
If they play off each other, they still got a really good shot in this game. It's just solo, they're not very strong, but as a team, their comp is very strong.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, Sejuani ulting the Soraka over the wall.
Could be really bad if they get triple in hit.
Yeah, oh my god. UNI Purple's so far behind. Their name is Graceland, I couldn't remember. Graceland's so ahead that their UNI Purple just can't fight back. Like, they try, but they just die faster than the enemy does.
You get a situation where one of the opposing laners becomes so strong, it almost requires two of your people at all points, so it becomes very difficult to move the numbers around and not just get run over. Lots of good signs from UNI that game, though. They were down early, but they figured out what they needed to do and played around each other and almost came back there.
Yeah, it just seemed like Graceland University were a little bit more on top of things that game. Mostly, I think having the CC on the jungler was good for Graceland because... Like, Pantheon has to either check Gwen in a side lane or be, like, committed to a fight. And that's not really good for his XP, and that's what we saw. And, like, what I'm saying is that it was good for Graceland to have CC at every fight. And for UNI Purple, it was only the fights that Pantheon was at that they had, like, reliable CC.
Yeah, I definitely agree. You and I lack the hard engage that I think they might need just to make these fights a bit more clear cut. The one thing I would say though about the Pantheon XP situation, the gank from Sejuani hurt him a lot because that wave was pushing out back to him. So when he's losing that, he's losing multiple waves of XP, and I think that's kind of where it started.
I think you're right. Like, even if she doesn't kill him, he can just lose so much, and that it's just an unfortunate part of top lane.
It's one of the sucky parts, but when you get killed and there's minions under your turret, it's way more than a 300 gold switch. I think one level approximately worth of stats is around 600 gold. So it's one level is a very big deal, and that 600 gold is way more early game because of the just disparity in total absolute levels of stats.
Mm-hmm. We'll see what goes on this game. We'll see if they end up like banning Gwen or Aurelion Sol or just letting him have it and trying to get a counter. But Yumi is pretty obnoxious to play against. I don't know if it's ban worthy, but
yeah, well, Tyler looked like he was playing very well though. So my suggestion might be to play some hard CC mid and look for some roams bottom, because they were pressuring very hard under turret early, even versus a Yumi.
So yeah, Tyler reliably uses his gold that he's given.
Yeah, so I think if Bailey plays something like a LeBlanc or something where she can help pressure when they're inside turret, that could be very dangerous. Or even just a Veigar to trap them under turret so Tyler gets some free time to get some shots off. She comes in, throws her ulti down. Could be very scary.
I think if Graceland doesn't ban Seraphine and Bailey gets that, then that's going to be a game changer for UNI Purple, because that is actually what usually happens, is they leave Seraphine open, and then they get a Seraphine ult to their entire team's face at one point or another in the game.
Yeah, those fights were definitely... UNI succeeded when they were able to get good, solid team fights together, and they could use all their abilities. So with that Seraphine ult, that would have been the difference maker in a lot of those fights. It's just a little bit easier to use in that Cassiopeia ult, more range. And, I mean, they can be looking at you or away from you, so.
And also it has a wind-up, so. Or not like a wind-up, but you know what I mean? Like, you can flash out or just turn the other way. If you're quick enough, you can literally click and face your character a different direction. I'm not gonna make the sound with myself, but you can hear the sound of her ult, and as soon as you hear the sound, you turn around, yeah, and like because she like inhales before it comes out, and I hear the inhale, I turn around.
Yeah, and unfortunately, Bailey didn't get the chance really to get her items in and become the dominant Sylaner that game that she had the potential to become if it went on a bit longer.
I think an Aurelion Sol ban would be good from UNI Purple. Oh, I have messages. Could ask everyone to bear with us here. Got some technical difficulties. client sucks.
It's a small indie company. What are you going to do?
Yeah, man. I think what we should do is petition to have another, like, Lux skin, or maybe like an Ahri skin.
I think a Jinx skin, you know, like.
Oh yeah, or maybe new Ezreal skin. I think he could use another.
For sure.
Just a little bit of love for those characters. Maybe that would make the client better if we give more character skins.
Remove one of the Ornn skins, you know, like. Oh. Too many.
Yeah, Ornn's been getting too much love, and his skins, he breaks. We don't like him. No more Ornn. I'm still waiting for like Pasta Mistress Alawi, and she her tentacles are giant spaghetti noodles. I've had this idea for years. When she alts, she goes "Mamma Mia!" and like meatballs and spaghetti go flying everywhere.
She gave me a great idea, dude. it's a similar theme skin. But instead, it's Nunu with, like, Ratatouille on top of his head.
Nunu with a big meatball? I like that.
Nunu, no, it's like Ratatouille. Like, he's got the Ratatouille.
Oh, yeah. Dude, instead of the snowball, it would be a meatball.
Yeah,
it'd
be perfect, dude.
Or they could have different... It could be one of their expensive skins, and they could have meatballs or, like, dough balls. I don't know.
Takes a bite, you hear him say "Mamma Mia."
I've also thought of like Spaghetti Fiora, and instead of a sword, she just has like a spaghetti noodle.
I mean, she's already got the like beach skin that's got the balloon noodle. So
she should have a skin that makes like Baker Fiora, and she has like a baguette as a sword.
They're just copying the Pantheon skin.
Yeah.
I don't know. They need more Renekton skins, what they need.
I'm still waiting for Burgot. Just looks like a burger. Tell me that wouldn't be awesome. Just like a burger with legs and arms and a head. Oh, that'd be so good.
They should just make an Urgot skin, but it's just, like, the old Urgot.
Wasn't his ult, like, point-and-click switch places with somebody? I think that's what that was.
Yeah, he was a really weird champion. I think it'd be a cool idea. All the reworked champions add a skin where it's just like their old champion.
There's Lee Sin skin that looks like garbage. It's called like traditional Lee skin. Traditional Lee Sin. It's his like concept art, but as a skin, it's interesting. If I remember correctly. I might be mistelling it.
That sounds like believable.
Yeah, it's how he was supposed to look, but they're like, "Eh, we'll make him look like this and have this skin, I guess." I don't know. Boulder got the bait and switch, so it was him. Yes, I remember correctly. It was so weird.
Yeah, his ult felt like useless. He was so weird.
It was just short range. It was pretty short range too. You had to get pretty close. It wasn't like melee. It was medium, but I don't know what. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was still like a new player when I played the old Urgot, so maybe it was just because I was bad. But
same.
I had no idea what I was doing with his ult.
Same. So we do see a Fiora and Zac and a Mumu ban from UNI again. And a Rakan, Maokai, and this time Soraka ban.
But Soraka was very good bot lane. Kept Tyler nice and healthy.
Ooh, okay. So they prio Gensel's Lulu. That's pretty good. I think that UNI Purple's got a great chance of winning this game no matter who Tyler picks as ADC, because when they have the Lulu and like hyper carry combo, because Tyler likes those hyper carries, they always stomp. So I'm excited for this game.
You know what? Bot laner goes really well with Lulu, right?
There's lots. Cog. Renekton, Lulu. I was gonna say Kog'Maw or Jinx.
Now Renekton, you dash in, she ults you, you knock them both up.
Oh wait a minute, wouldn't her picks autos apply to every one of your W autos?
Yeah.
Dude, that is nasty.
Lulu Renekton's honestly not the best. You more want like a CC person, but Lulu's fine. You should play a bit more passive. Got the Xayah Yuumi. Switching it up again. JK.
Okay, so they do get the Bailey Joe Seraphine. This is looking like a pretty good draft for UNI so far. I think it would be good to get Brayden in the top lane on like a reliable tank rather than a Warwick or a Pantheon or even rather than a Camille. I think he would do well this game just like scaling so that Tyler can get strong, so that now Kane can get strong. That's a good pick. I've not seen him go Kane, so I'm excited. I think he went Kane once last week. Or not last week, the week before. And it was okay. I don't remember.
Kane can be really strong.
Yeah, especially Red Kane. I think he's really good.
I think Blue Kane's scary, at least from the ADC perspective.
Yeah, I mean, I've been one shot by many a Blue Kane, but I have killed and like stomped many more Blue Canes into the dirt. It's so glass cannon, especially if they don't know what they're doing. You can mess up you're supposed to one combo as Blue Kane, but you can mess it up if you do damage and then like walk away. His passive is important in Blue Kane. You get like a damage bonus at the start when you fight someone, and then your passive goes on cooldown. So you need to go in all in at once. And that's how I just beat Blue Canes. I just wait for them to hit something and try to get away. Or don't even wait for them. Just run away. I don't know. It's Blue Cane, you got to get fed. You got to keep staying on top of it. It's not a pick against Sejuani. If he goes blue versus Sejuani, they're going to have a bad time. I've played a lot of Cane. I have died on Cane a lot. I have not died on Kane a lot. It's all about when he gets his form, which form he decides to go.
Maybe if he played like a Kled top, a bit more tanky, has a bit more engage for the team.
Okay, yeah, I could get behind a Kled.
I never liked playing that champion personally, but he is very, very good for the team. Using his, I believe it's his W, it's his auto attack passive. It's always a little bit annoying in lane.
Mm-hmm.
But very, very strong.
Action? I think this is an action top, maybe? I don't know who's going action here, but I like it. It's spicy. Yasuo, okay, Gensel's going Yasuo bot. This is hype. But, or not Gensel, Tyler, my bad. My bad, it's hype, dude. It's so hype. When Tyler goes Yasuo... Or Zeri, like last game was pretty hype, but he popped a couple weeks ago as Yasuo bot. As Tyler, when are they gonna add Tyler as a champion? Okay. Okay, so they leave the Aurelion Sol in. I think that's gonna be fine, especially with Seraphine in mid. Doesn't matter what goes on. Really can do whatever. The team, UNI Purple's team fight is a lot better, and they know how to play it. The Mordekaiser ult's going to be annoying. They got to watch out for that later, but a QSS solves that pretty easy. Action can maneuver himself out of, or not out, but around Mordekaiser ult if he plays correctly. I don't know. It's going to be... interesting game for sure. They're UNI purple this draft, it makes me think they want to kind of grab this game by the reins a little bit more than last game. So, like, rather than playing a little bit more passive and farming up, they have, like, a Yasuo pick. They have a Kane pick.
I agree. I think this is going to be a complete 180 from last game. We're not going to see this slow start again. It's going to be a lot of action-packed early kills.
I didn't know that Brayden could play action. I wasn't caught up on that, but I do know that Tyler is insane on Yasuo. Well, no, insane in the membrane.
A nice revive from the Akshan this game.
Mm-hmm. It only takes like one or two good revives to really change a game as action. So I say good revives, just revives, because it's good.
Yeah, if it gets late game, any revive's a good revive once the timer gets above 40, 50 seconds.
A big part of action, I don't know how much action you've played, is like almost, because I've played a lot of Twitch too. I've played a ton of Twitch. You kind of got to get in the enemy's head and like think, okay, they think that I'm here, so I will either be there or I won't be there. But you have to like think about that. And that's pretty important on action, because his reveal range for when he's stealth is pretty big, and it's kind of hard to stay stealth as action. You have to be near a wall or in a bush. So using that stuff is really important to be able to get the revives off. Because if you just reveal yourself too early, you get focused.
Yeah, I'm not much of an Akshan player myself. I've played against it quite a bit. I don't know, people seem to think it's good against Renekton. I don't think it is.
I'm thinking about the logistics of it, and I don't think it is.
Yeah, that's a very interesting thing you brought up, that reveal range. That will be a very big key, just making sure that the enemy team doesn't have the information, because that's what this game's all about, having more information than your opponent.
Especially with Aurelion Sol, Sejuani, and Mordekaiser, like... I guess less Aurelion Sol, but if any of those guys are near each other and near action, if action gets revealed, they're gonna dive him so hard. I mean, I would. What's the worst that could happen? Just catch that dude out and kill him.
Yeah, Akshan can pump the damage if he gets that open window.
Another thing I like about UNI's draft is they all, to some degree, less Lulu, less Seraphine, but it's true for both of them. They all have a good amount of agency on their own. Like, they can fight back on their own. Like, they, like, Action doesn't necessarily need Kane to fight people. He can still get out or do a good amount of damage. Especially true for Yasuo. It's true for Kane, too. He doesn't need everybody there. I mean, he would like them, but...
I put some respect on Lulu early game, dude. She pumps.
If you can get the autos off, yeah. Although her range is pretty big.
Lulu, no joke, is quite a bit of a high damage support if you can manage to get those trades off. Probably not in this matchup when she's versus Yumi. Won't be really focusing on that aspect of Lulu versus Yumi, but...
Mordekaiser ult's going to be really important this game. Yumi ult's going to be important less this game as it was last game, I think. I don't know.
Just trying to think about how these team fights are going to play out. Just driving my mind in circles, man. Like, it's going to be very complicated. Is it, if they can stay together, they're just going to wipe them. But if they get separated, it'll make it a little scary.
Yeah, it's really hard for me to think about with the Kane ult, or the Kane ult, the Mord ult, the Sejuani ult, and the Aurelion Sol ult, and the Seraphine ult. It's really hard to think about how these fights are going to go. Because, like, it's just going to be like who gets hit. Who uses what when?
I think the main takeaway I would say from this game is, as long as it's close, Tyler can carry any team fight if he gets a good team fight.
So for sure.
Keep the game close, and he always has the carry potential.
Yeah, if Bailey can get her Leandre's or Rylai's before Aurelion Sol gets too far ahead, because it's going to happen. Aurelion's just going to get strong this game. She can't stop it as Seraphine, really. Then she'll be fine, because then she'll be able to deal with him in the team fights and the rest of their team.
Yeah, man, I'm excited to see this Yasuo gameplay. I want to see some good action.
Oh, you better grab your popcorn and buckle up, Buckaroo, because I hope I'm not going to jinx everything, but he's pretty insane on Yasuo, so we'll see. There are some Yasuo changes coming in that I thought were interesting. I saw this today. They're making it so his E can be charged. So now, right now, if you E stuff two times, it will do its the most damage it can do. But they're making it so it's four times next patch, and it's going to do more damage. And instead of doing like a flat amount of damage, it's going to do percent-based damage. So you can build like full AP Yasuo and nearly one-shot people with your E. It's pretty interesting.
As a Renekton player, it's always tough to respect Yasuo because Renekton just stuns him. But Yasuo is a very dangerous player in teamfights. If they don't respect the Yasuo, he will just wipe the whole team.
And Tyler is really slippery on all of the characters he plays, and we're going to see it on Yasuo too. He'll be able to get in and out.
And they don't really have a bunch of options to deal with him besides just the Mordekaiser ulti, as long as he uses his wind wall very well.
Yeah, it's. I think if Sejuani gets onto Yas as a Yas player, because I've played a lot of Yas, as a Yas player, I don't want Sejuani on me. I could fight Mord maybe at some point in the game. It kind of depends if he's feeding or not. If Mord is doing what he needs to do, I'm probably not going to beat Mord as Yasuo.
Even then, though, if the Sejuani gets on you and you can still get the wind wall out and you have some backup behind you, you might be able to get out of there alive and stop the enemy team from engaging, because a lot of them need to get through that wind wall.
The wind wall is going to be really important this game. If Sejuani could like toss her ult into that and ruin things for her team pretty quickly.
Like, we're just going to see a 5-point again. Both teams not really wanting to risk it early. Neither of them had a very good invade either. I do think Graceland does have a decent invade, though, if they wanted to try it.
Yeah, I think Kane might benefit from, like, walking out a little bit. I don't know if he started Q or W. Probably Q. He might be able to get some early points in his passive off. Like, the faster he gets it, the better, because he's kind of not a character until he gets it. Minions have spawned. Kane does have Conqueror, so I predict he's going to go red. He can still go blue with Conqueror, but you see it less.
It looks like Kane is going to path topside, so they can stay coordinated and keep the wave pushing in at the right time. This could be a good gank potential top.
Mm-hmm. Action's gonna play pretty safe versus Mord. I mean, like, he can dunk on Mord, but if he gets caught by Mordekaiser's spells, Action's in for a really, really, really bad time.
Mordekaiser did get that early ward on Blue, though, so he's definitely really worried about it. He wants to see when Kane's in the area.
Yeah. Doesn't want to give away some free points to him, it looks like. That Lulu auto, damn.
She hurts?
Yeah.
Her Q's also got a really high base damage.
So they're going to spot Kane over here. Action is going in for a trade here, but Sejuani is on the way. Is Kane going to counter gank? We'll see. He's in position to start going for the counter gank. He should be heading up right now. He is. So Action's chasing a little too far forward. Flash is out of the way of the Sejuani Q. I can't see what's going on top. Okay. Not a lot is going on top. The trade is over, it seems. Although Kane is waiting by the wall. Meanwhile, Yasuo bot lane is going in really hard. They do have to flash away from the Yas because they're scared. Mord does get a EQ combo on the Action, but Kane is there for the counter gank Sedge is there for the counter gank as Kane ganks. He gets some points. That's good for him.
If I was the Kane there, I might have helped that Akshon crash the wave. He's in a little bit of a scary
spot
right now.
Look top. They're still dancing around each other up here because Sejuani still has flash and Akshon is pushed out with no flash.
Yeah, this Akshon's very low. He needs to get this wave crash, or like we talked about last game, he might get a really big XP deficit, which is just very brutal to come back from.
Mm-hmm. It seemed like Mordekaiser and Sejuani were communicating that and trying to get him, and luckily UNI Purple is also communicating that the Kane and the Akshon were talking about it. So they grouped up, and then Action backed. That was good, I think. I think he's going to lose some XP top, but it's good for him to back. Just get out of there. Stop the shenanigans.
It's tough to say for sure, but I think he came out ahead with how many minions Sejuani and the Mordekaiser shared worth of XP. So I think he actually came out ahead on that.
We'll see here. He is pretty behind. CS. Oh, okay, he dodges the E. Oh, he does mess up his E into the wall though, and misses out on a pretty good amount of damage and an escape.
I think that's a pretty good trade for him though. The wave's crashing into him, so he's not missing a bunch of XP.
Oh, Yas really wants it right now. He does throw out the wind wall, but they do kill him. And they're gonna get the Lulu as well. That's unfortunate for UNI Verbal Bot. I think that they were a little bit too aggressive there. Yas was tanking a lot of minions during those fights because he kept attacking the enemies in range of the minions. I didn't see if he took any tower shots too. He was getting pretty close. But I think he needs to not be so much in your face disgrace right now as Yasuo. He's not strong enough for that. He needs to be getting the Q3s and then going for it.
Especially without the jungler right there to back him up. Graceland had their jungler actually a bit closer.
Mm-hmm.
I think Tyler felt a bit safe knowing his Kane was on Krugs, but the Sejuani was actually in the river a little bit closer.
Bless you. And Action is being zoned off of farm. That's pretty bad for him right now. He needs to be getting these minions now, but Mordekaiser knows that and he's not letting him. Kane doing a little bit of a desperate Drake play. I like it. They can do it. Might be kind of shot here if Lulu walks straight there and they realize it, but there's no one to stop them, so it doesn't matter if they realize. So that's a good play by UNI Purple. Kane needs to reset. They've been found. Oh, they're gonna catch the Aurelion's Soul. He's gonna flash away. That's Aurelion's ult. It's pretty good for UNI Purple. They only lost the Seraphine ult, which isn't like a terribly long cooldown. Or they didn't. Seraphine didn't even ult. That was the Seraphine E. My bad.
It is gonna be tough.
Oh, Sejuani catching. Sejuani says catch has caught Bailey Joe, and Aurelion's on the way. Kane is on the way, and so is Action. We're gonna see a scuffle up here. How hard is Kane gonna commit? That's the question. Not very hard. He just wants a little bit of points. Hits the W, walks away. Meanwhile, bot, Xayah is just destroying these two. It's a hard matchup for Yasuo. Especially when, now that she's got some gold.
Yeah, and it's gonna be really difficult for Akshon to get to his footing back now that Mordekaiser has six.
Sejuani found Kayn at his Raptors, and he did have to flash away there. Kayn, you need to back. Well, bro, you haven't backed. I know, I see you taking those camps. He's gotta have a ton of gold.
Doesn't have a lot of gank opportunities up right now, though.
Oh, they do get a freebie on the Sejuani, who's out of position. Yas is about to go apeshit. Here he goes. He flashes in. He gets the Q3. Oh, man, they're both dead.
That's really big, getting a lot of gold on Yas there.
See, that's the thing about Tyler's Yasuo. He knows when to go, like, really hard like that. And that's really important. That's gonna be what wins the game for UNI Purple.
They're going to have to really focus on dealing with this Mordekaiser quick, though, because if he gets too big, it's going to be even difficult for the Yas to deal with, though.
He might be getting to be too big already, man. He's got a lot of farm.
It's going to be very scary, and it's always difficult to deal with the Mordekaiser when he's got his R up, too.
Ah, Mordekaiser missed cannon. Okay, so Yas and Lulu doing some shenanigans under their turret here. They are not able to get the Yas ult off on that Lulu ult. I think they may have been able to get the kill if they did.
Definitely would have been close.
I don't know, though. It's tough with the Yumi. Sejuani trying to help shove in so Raylan can back. And can only shove so much against the Seraphine. Sejuani looking for a top gank, I think. Meanwhile, bot. I think Sejuani's gonna commit when she sees that Kayn commits. Yes, she is. Kayn showed she immediately went in. So Kayn is going in, bot. The Yumi is able to take down the Yasuo. That's really bad for UNI Purple. Kayn ults inside of that. The Xayah. Sorry. Xayah's doing so much damage. He can't keep up. He's got cooldowns. He's got to run. Is he going to try to turn? No, he isn't. He's still running for his life. Lulu's going to help him get out. Oh, and Xayah ults to get the kill. And Yumi Qs for the cleanup on Lulu. That's devastating for UNI Purple to have the Yasuo die so soon into the fight. He's most of UNI Purple's damage right now. Kayn is the other bit. Meanwhile, top, Sejuani ganked and it didn't work, but just sat there. That's evil. Ults the action. He does have to blow flash.
I think if Mordekaiser saved his E there for that time with the pull, I think he might have died there.
Yeah. UNI Purple is not out of this game yet, folks. Don't even start thinking that. They have the Seraphine, they have the Yasuo Lulu combo. While Seraphine is taking quite a bit of damage and even dying to Aurelion, I think they're gonna win the game. Because their team fight is crazy. They just need to get out of the lanes. They need to push and they need to do it as fast as they can.
Yeah, all the Yasuo needs is gold and he can carry any game, so.
Mm-hmm. And he's trying right now. He's going in on the Xayah. She's got her feathers everywhere. Can't really get a good E. She tries. He windwalls it. He's still fighting her. No Q3.
I think you and I need to try as much to play around the Yasuo as possible and just start getting him gold.
Oh, Yasuo gets the knockup. He ults, and meanwhile Yumi is ulting. Is the Xayah gonna get away with the Yumi? It looks like she is. Yas is having a hard time getting to the minions and doing his thing. Meanwhile, Lulu's holding them off. Misses the Q3, they're so low! He's gonna get another Q3 up. Can they do it this time? Kayn has come to help. She has decided the turret is the way to go, and Yumi is gonna get the execute. I hate the stupid cat. I do. Oh, do it, Kayn! Yes!
That's huge. That's really
that
big
is
for you and
so
I.
Big for you and I. Oh my god. God, that would. I'm like tilted watching that.
Those little mistakes are what cost league games. You and I gets the gold they need to start coming back.
Lulu and Yas are really low and they are really out of position here. Aurelion Sol is going to find them and so is Sejuani. Lulu is going to get caught and die. Yas might be able to get out of here with Bailey Joe though. The Seraphine. Oh, Kane goes popping over the wall. He's here. He's the savior. But Aurelion Sol ults. There's so much damage. Sejuani has to run. So does Aurelion. But the bot lane shows up too. Oh, and it's kind of over for UNI Purple at this point. I think they committed a little bit too hard. And Bailey Joe is going to die as well. Yas is out. Okay, I thought he was going to cancel his back for a sec. It's part of his animation. My bad. Yeah, so, UNI not coming out on top. And Graceland, they're able to win there. I think what went wrong is they chased. UNI Purple committed a little bit too hard at the wrong time. And Grayson's bot lane got back, and that's what ruined the fight.
Yeah, honestly, I think if Bailey just leaves there a little earlier, I think she gets out, and that's still an even trade. And maybe they can't get Dragon there if she's not chunked out and can pressure them off.
Mm-hmm. UNI only down 3,000 gold despite this. Yasuo is going in again. I don't think he's committing. He took so much damage for that. Meanwhile, mid, there's a Rift Herald dropped. Mid turret is not falling, but there is a scuffle going on that seems to have ended in nobody dying.
I feel like Yasuo could really just use his team to guarantee these engages and kind of force them.
Oh, he is engaging hard on these guys. Yumi decided to ult after Yasuo ulted. They are flashing, they're doing everything they can, but they can't quite catch her. Mordekaiser ulted the action. Action is trying to E away inside of the ult. He cannot do it. Uh-oh, and Sejuani's up there too, so it doesn't even matter that he's going to survive. What Action needed to do there was have Mordekaiser run to the wall that he E'd to, and E to the other wall. The wall that was near his turret. So he needed to, like, get Mordekaiser. He needed to kite Mordekaiser and then like run away and still have Mordekaiser being kited. But what happened was like he E'd that wall and Mordekaiser's like, well, you're probably not going to go towards my turret, and just walk towards his turret and just cut him off. And there's nothing he could do. So I think next time Action's going to have to use his E in a little bit different way. His E's so hard to use though. I think Aurelion just tried to ult Bailey Joe? Yeah, he did. I think that was his Empower ult. I don't know, because I saw something like appear in the river. And it looked like the outer ring of Aurelion ult, and Bill was running away at like one health. So I think he tried to kill her with the ring. I don't know about that one. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I don't know. I couldn't tell, so.
Okay, because his ult was on cooldown right after. Okay, he does so much damage. Oh man. UNI Purple's trying. Yas is still alive. They still can win the fight. I don't know though. The Sejuani's dealing a lot of CC, and Yas does not like that. Yeah, that fight was kind of over when Kane and Yas were not in sync. Kane kept going in kind of because he had to, but Yas stopped going in because Yas had to stop going in.
Yeah,
it was odd.
That was an even number fight. If they can just get a fight where they have the extra numbers here, like if they can get Bailey to rotate quickly.
Yeah, it's tough.
Really close. The Oswald just needs a split second just to start his engage.
UNI Purple decides to have Bailey go top to cover the Mord and have Action go bot. See, yeah, Yas and Lulu going mid. I think that's a good call. I would probably keep Action against Mord, because I feel like he has a little bit more chance of getting away from Mord than Seraphine does.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think Akshon can really do much versus Zaya. Not when the Zaya has more, a lot more gold.
Yeah, Graceland overall does have
looks
a lot more
on
gold.
Rift Herald.
Yeah, they're gonna keep using this 8,000 gold lead they have wherever they can. They're gonna keep trying to make it bigger. So they grab Rift Herald. Well, I'm interested to see where they drop it.
This could be a good fight.
Okay, so Mordekaiser just walks up to Seraphine and ults her, which is exactly what I was talking about before. She can't do anything. So it sucks. I wouldn't say it's troll to build a QSS, even if you don't finish the item. Okay, Kayn and Yas just catch their bot lane, Grayson's bot lane right now, and they're trying to follow up in the jungle, but they can't do quite enough damage. And Zaya's still walking away, but Sedge is still running him down. Action gets a great kill on the Zaya there. I don't think that revives anybody though, no. Yas does fall, that's pretty bad for UNI purple. Oh, and the Mordekaiser flash queues in on the action to kill him. Could be Drake 3 for Graceland.
Yeah, not the best fight for UNI. Graceland had a little bit too much peel, but that was a really good attempt by Kyle. Just trying to get him with their ulti, trying to pick them off quickly.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy how fast and hard Sejuani like disengages these fights.
Yeah, that disengage plus that Yumi just keeping that Zaya alive for just long enough to be a problem.
Okay, so Kayn finds Mordekaiser in his jungle. He's not pleased. He does try to fight him. I think he's rapidly regretting his decisions. He's baiting, maybe? I don't know what's going on. He does have to blow flash after he misses W.
Mordekaiser doesn't have R. This could be a good situation if they can keep him on the map.
They do have to do it fast, though, because his R is coming up. And they don't really have time to chase because mid is being pushed as well.
Yeah, looks like they need to back off.
Yeah, they need to back off now. It's a lost cause at this point. Yasuo and Lulu sneaking around in mid. Action might get ulted by Mord there, so he's gotta be careful. Oh! Yas tries to windwall the Sedge ult, but is not quite able to do so. It gets hit by it, and some things are happening. Kayn was able to ult in onto the Zaya and get back in there, but he was not able to kill her, and he ends up dying. Action tries to help, and he ends up dying. Yas is having a hard time, and Mordekaiser ult. Now he's out of it inside of the entire Graceland team, kind of. He ults the Mordekaiser, he's fighting at Raptors. Meanwhile, Graceland's killing Lulu under her turret, and Yas is dead. Damn. It looks like the same situation as last game where UNI Purple is just behind and is having a really hard time keeping up with Graceland right now.
Yeah, they're just a little bit behind, so Graceland has that prio where they're just a little bit more grouped up where UNI can be.
Now that I'm like looking at it more and thinking about it more, the Sejuani Aurelion Soul combo is really gross, disgusting. Like, Aurelion has not great CC, but okay CC. Like, his ult is a pretty big area, especially the empowered one. But like, see, like that plus Sejuani stuff, like you cannot do anything, especially with Aurelion's damage. And UNI is having a really hard time dealing with that at the moment.
Yeah, UNI, anytime they want to fight, has been taking a lot of damage just for even prospects. It's been tough just to even get for angles. So if you saw that bot lane where Yasuo was dueling and just taking all that damage going in. And Sejuani plus Aurelion Soul combo, just the CC plus that raw damage from the Aurelion Soul.
Yeah, if you decide to check in, like, even if you end up beating him, he's still gonna smack you. He's just gonna hold his Q at you. It does so much. So it's really tough. I think UNI Purple should be not necessarily not focusing Zaya. She's a great focus, but maybe putting a little bit more emphasis into killing Aurelion Soul, because he hasn't died at all. He's got a big bounty. he does insane damage every fight. I think it would be good to kill him. But yeah, UNI purple's gonna see, they're gonna see this Xayah pick here, maybe. They're going on her, kind of, but they're not committing.
They're all grouped up though, this could lead to a good situation.
Yeah, they're gonna have to do it fast though, because Mord is pushing bot and Aurelion's pushing top. Aurelion's probably gonna swing in. I'd keep going if I were Mord. Sedge ults that guy. Oh, Kane is not able to get inside of anybody before he gets killed by the turret. Meanwhile, Sedge is running them down. Yas gets a... He goes in for the ult there. Oh, man, and it's over because he gets killed, and then Lulu gets killed, and Action just has to run. He has no one to peel him because Lulu and Seraphine are dead.
They just have so much damage so quickly with that Xayah.
Yeah, UNI purple, this game and last game, I'm not sure if it's the Yumi, if people are missing spells, or it's like just the game itself, but what is happening is they keep going for like the carries. Oh, and Kane is going to try to stop them, but he's going to die on the way back. Does he die? No, he was so close. His health is so low. But what UNI purple keeps doing is they keep committing like a lot of resources to try to kill these carries, and they keep not killing the carries, but they keep doing it again and trying anyways, and that's what's bad. And it's losing them the game, because they're not, it's not like, okay, we need to approach this differently. This guy's not dying. They keep doing the same thing. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, they just are pretty disjointed, where it just seems like the team isn't really cohesive on a lot of their plays. A lot of the lanes are making individual decisions instead of team decisions.
It's a tough spot to be in. I think what influences that for them right now is just like they're down 15,000 gold on Graceland. And so they're all probably thinking, what do we do? I don't know though.
Yeah, once it gets to this point, it can be difficult, but it also is very easy to get back. You just have to like stay in the right position, and then eventually, the team.
Oh, Seraphine steals the Drake. You're right. Stay in the right positions. As you're saying it, Bill steals the Drake. Yas is doing some stuff over here, holding off two people, three people, but he does die to the Aurelion over the wall. Seraphine does her best to try to live there, and it's going to be an ace for Graceland. It's what I'm trying to say is like, I think it's just the game, man. Like they are just so far ahead. Like no matter how hard you and I like tries, they have to monumentally outplay them to win here. Like,
Graceland just has so many damage sources where it's,
yeah,
they go for a carry, but like us, it's not really the carry. They have too much overall damage to just dive in on one person.
And that's gonna be the series for UNI purple. It sucks. I had a good time watching, but I mean, I feel bad just because you hate to see your team lose. But if chat wants to interview anybody, request so if you have questions as well. Otherwise, we'll be here next week. I don't know, man. Those games just didn't feel right. That's the biggest thing with me right now, is it just didn't feel right. I think it was the Yumi, maybe. Maybe it was the Sejuani.
Both games, thinking back, like the couple similarities they had, you and I had a couple early deaths that kind of really set them behind pace-wise, and they kind of set the tone for the rest of the game, where they're
especially in the
just
top.
Always on the back foot chasing behind.
I think
kind of just reacting to all the plays Graceland was making instead of kind of coming up with their own decisions to get back into the game quickly.
Right. I think they tried to do that, but they ended up failing, and it hurt them pretty bad for a while in bot lane the second game.
I think they definitely had like moments where they did it perfectly, and we saw that in both games where they had team fights that went their direction, but they just couldn't turn that to the next team fight. I don't know, they didn't have the same mentality, but just kind of one well, team fight would go very well, and the next one would kind of be a little bit more disjointed.
I just realized half of Graceland's team had matching names, so maybe that was it. they all had like GU at the start, or a bunch of them did, of the start of their names. I don't know. I think I'll say I'm excited for next week. I don't know if you and I, Purple, was able to practice this weekend, and they didn't play last week, so maybe they were shaking a little bit of that rust off. But I don't think that tonight was their worst performance. I think that they do well. They're gonna do well next week. I don't know. I like watching them. No questions.
Yeah, I don't think the end score kind of reflects how close the games were, because
they're
very close, and you and I had a lot of chances where if one thing goes a little differently, they're just completely back in the game.
I say every week, and I'll say again this week, because I feel like I've been kind of down, and I apologize. I'm rooting for you and I, but what I say every week is that they are fighters, and they will always fight. Like, both of those games, their back was against the wall, and both of those games, they may not have... you were talking about the reactionary versus looking for plays. They might not have looked for as many plays as they necessarily should have, but they were still looking for those plays. And, like, we saw Aiden get the smite steal in the first game. We saw Bailey Joe get the steal in the second game, right at the end. So, that's why I like watching UNI Purple. They don't give up, and I don't know. We'll see you next week, because there's no questions. See ya.
Wow, 这一路上的奇迹都记住了你的每一个瞬间，无比的耀眼。